Robert Daly is director of the Kissinger Institute on China and the United States at the Wilson Center. He joins us for another edition of Now. Robert, welcome.
Thank you.
We're going to be talking about the Hong Kong protests today. And the first thing I want to ask you is how you would characterize the current situation. I think we're calling it a standoff. What is the proper description of where we stand right now?
Well, first, it's not a revolution. Some people are calling this an umbrella revolution, and even the students themselves reject that notion. They are not revolutionaries. They
are
looking for
a
change. It's not that big. As of today, it appears that the demonstrations are winding down. There are other factors that could cause them to escalate again. But it looks as though, with discussions being planned between the government and the students, with the police not having done anything coercive over the past several days, the numbers going down, the moderate middle in Hong Kong coming back to the fore, it looks like the movement is going to go into another quieter phase for the time being.
Just peter out quietly?
Peter out, but not go away. I think that the students can claim success in many regards.
How so?
They have not changed Beijing's mind, nor will they. Beijing holds all the cards. However, they have brought worldwide attention to the false choice, the sort of fake democracy that was offered to the people of Hong Kong through Beijing's, the National People's Congress's August 31st decision. That is now out there. They have, in a sense, legitimized protest, even though Beijing has said that this was illegal. In fact, there was support. Hong Kong didn't close down. They were relatively well-behaved. And while not everybody supports them by any means, I think that their behavior and their limited goals mean that they have, in essence, reserved the right to come out again. The world's attention is on them. That's a success.
Why are they willing to not go away completely, but as you say, move to this next phase and maybe disperse from the encampments?
Well, they've been realistic right along about how much give was in Beijing and therefore how much was in Hong Kong.
Did they ask for anything specific?
They did. They asked for CY Leung, the leader of Hong Kong, to resign. That's specific, and that, of course, is not going to happen. And they also asked for Beijing basically to reconsider its decision of August 31st and to allow a nominating procedure which would give the people of Hong Kong a real choice between candidates in the 2017 elections. But they are the 2017 elections. This is 3 years away. It's not imminent. It's a long game.
Is Beijing buying time, or will they seriously consider the request?
They will not seriously consider the request. They will consider how to best handle the demonstrations. But Beijing sees itself as already gradually giving more rights to Hong Kong. And Hong Kong, remember, already has a higher standard of living, far more civil liberties than most of China, and many people within China, including the young Chinese, who don't know much about what's going on in Hong Kong because there's been a news blackout, but they're not necessarily sympathetic with the Hong Kongers. They see them in some cases as ingrates, as pushing too far too fast, as threatening the body politic. And over the past several years, we've seen growing cultural friction between the people of Hong Kong, many of whom see themselves as Hong Kongers first and Chinese second, if at all, and the people of China. People in Hong Kong call the mainlanders locusts, plague of locusts. And there are people on the mainland, a famous faculty member at Beijing University, who've called the Hong Kongers dogs of the British.
How organized are the protesters?
They're not highly organized. This is a movement, if that's the right word, without real leadership. There's the Occupy Central, more organized group, mostly of older people, but they've sort of taken a back seat to the students. The students are also not unified. They're not experienced. The most prominent leader, Joshua Wong, is only 17, impassioned, committed, intelligent, only 17. And so it's not a unified movement. There are different voices. And again, they don't seem to speak necessarily for the majority of the people of Hong Kong.
Well, what do we know about public opinion as far as Hong Kong's support for the protesters or objection to the protesters?
It would appear to be in play. Hong Kongers, generally speaking, are conservative. Hong Kong is a place that's very much about making money, but it's also a place that is accustomed to enjoying civil liberties. And then the real issue, Hong Kong is modern. Hong Kong participates in modernity in a way that China still doesn't. And I think this gives us a clue as to how we should look at it. Many Americans, a lot of the media, speak as though the story is this outpost of modernity and can it defend its civil liberties and other rights from China. I think that's the wrong lens. Hong Kong is part of the People's Republic of China. Irrevocably, that doesn't change. Its fate is tied to China's. So what happens in Hong Kong is really part of the broader story of China's ongoing struggle with modernization. I think that's the more accurate lens to which we can look at this problem.
This, in a way, did what happened in Tiananmen Square create protection for these protesters?
That is a very interesting way of looking at it. I think there may be a sense in which it does. And there's a sense in which the comparisons to Tiananmen Square might also help Xi Jinping. Hmm. There are certain ways in which he comes out of this, and the Chinese Communist Party comes out of this looking bad. The world's attention is on what's going on in Hong Kong. Perhaps most importantly, this really calls the one country, two systems approach that the mainland has taken to Hong Kong, and this is the same formula it offers to Taiwan. It really sounds the death knell for that approach. The people in Taiwan are having nothing of it, but they weren't very interested in it before. At the same time, because there have been all of these comparisons made to Tiananmen, and because to date Beijing has stayed its hand, if this peters out calmly, Xi Jinping can come out looking relatively enlightened and looking like he has exercised deft leadership. Nobody has been hurt. So this does potentially help Xi in the lead up to the meeting with President Obama in November.
A final thought, Robert, is as we look ahead, last time we discussed fears of infiltration of cultural values, Western cultural right. values. Does Beijing look at this, what's happening in Hong Kong and in the streets of Hong Kong, and think this could be a preview of what may happen in Beijing sometime soon?
There's clearly some of that. And Beijing has said that the protesters are a small number of people. This is what they always say when there are protests. And that they are being influenced or backed or manipulated by Western powers, including the United States and Great Britain.
In other words, they're outliers. They don't represent.
They're outliers. These are not really the people of Hong Kong. And this is what they say vis-a-vis some of the activity in Xinjiang, sometimes in Tibet, that this is American-inspired in part, like some of the color revolutions. They will, and like in Beijing's view, the Maidan having been manipulated by the United States. So yes, this is part of the narratives are Chinese struggles with modernization, but this struggle, or the relationship between the United States and China. China's attitudes toward American ideas are also part of the story.
Well, thanks again. And when you come back next month, we're going to talk about the president's trip, I believe.
I look forward to it.
Look forward to that. Thanks again.
Thank you.